hear some reindeer on your rooftop or Jack Frost on your windowsill. But if someone's climbing down your chimney, you better load your gun and shoot to kill. Oh, it's Christmas at Ground Zero. And if
the Cold War was absolutely one of the most serious events that had ever happened on this planet, and certainly in humanity's time on this rock. For the first time in our history, we possessed the ability to wipe out our entire species in the blink of an eye, not to mention most of the rest of the life on this planet. Is there any stronger reason why we see so much humor in our Cold War media both during and after the passive conflict? Humanity and humor, and the exact reason why we laugh or find things amusing, is still not fully understood by neuroscience, although research suggests it's an evolutionary byproduct. But we do understand types of humor and the Cold War and the Western media that came out of it. Certain types of comedy is used to poke fun at the genre, as well as the futility of mutually assured destruction.
Mr. President, I think they're trying the number.
You can't fight in here. This is the war room.
Gallows humor is a defense mechanism we see constantly used by those in perilous situations. The military, often finding themselves in situations where survival looked bleak, have been notorious throughout history for having the blackest sense of humor towards their own survival ability. This can definitely be seen with a lot of the protagonists in Cold War media. We can look at one of the earliest and most famous comedies about the Cold War, Stanley Kubrick's Dr. Strangelove, or How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love the Bomb. A common trope in Cold War movies, that being a series of oopsies or a one or more madmen in charge of nuclear devices, is both used here, but in a manner of black humor, as we strip back the ultimate annihilation and we're given a chance to look at the men involved in this unfortunate event for humanity. Flawed, often silly people, including our idea of a hero, Sam Pickens, is turned on its side as he fights to deliver payloads like any true American hero. Only we don't want him to. The president has a strained relationship with the Soviet premier, not from political strife, but he's been ghosting him on the regular on their talks together. The madman behind it all is completely crazy and has managed to hide this long enough to get him in a position to start World War III. We look at these failures of personality in the system as a human factor, one of the most unstable in the conflict, and ripe for dark humor. However, lighter fare is to be had in cold media.
I'm Rocky and this is Bullwinkle. Who are you?
Yodely doddly hodly ho!
Gentlemen, allow me to introduce myself.
The 60s, including definitely products aimed at children, including the cartoon Rocky and Bullwinkle, had a running bit about two Russian spies, Boris and Natasha, trying desperately not only to bring their glorious Soviet Union to prominence, but also to thwart their real rivals, Moose and Squirrel. This type of humor relies on a lot of two fronts, not only poking fun at the tropes that have become associated with the Cold War and spy media, but at the enemy and their incompetence, here in the form of two bumbling spies who are constantly being thwarted by the clever and one step ahead American wildlife. While there is some fun poked at our side in Rocky and Bullwinkle, another 60s show, Get Smart, would poke fun at the spy genre and its tropes, along with making fun of those on both sides. Our heroes are not super smooth Bond types. They're as much bumbling fools as many as their enemies that they go up against. Their gadgets are direct parodies of Bond's bag of tricks, exaggerated for comedic effect.
Well, shouldn't we activate the cone of silence?
The cone of silence?
Yes.
All right, Max. Hodgkins.
Yes, sir.
Activate the cone of silence.
The cone of silence?
First of all, how much... How much do you know about chaos?
What did you say, sir?
In post-war comedy of the spy genre, we have one of the most prominent examples, and again, playing heavily on James Bond, particularly the Sean Connery 60s Bond, we have the Austin Powers trilogy. While much of the series has fun like Get Smart with the ridiculous gadgets and equally often silly villains of the Bond franchise, it is set up as a time travel movie, with powers returning from a cryo freeze in the 60s to a modern late 90s post-Cold War setting. Austin touches on the culture of the 60s comedically from decades later, with commentary on his own character, who's a spy, but really he's a swinging hippie socialist, despite working for the UK, and his immediate assumption upon hearing the Cold War was, well...
The Cold War's over.
Well, finally those capitalist pigs will pay for their crimes, eh? Hey, comrades, hey?
Austin, we won.
Oh, groovy, smashing, yay capitalism.
The first movie especially deals with the tension in the era, while poking fun at tropes through modern eyes, such as Dr. Evil not being aware of inflation, as well as Bond's villains' penchant for leaving their enemies in elaborate traps and walking away. But on a much darker tone, you have the comedy that makes even Dr. Strangelove look lighthearted, with the comedian's character in Watchmen. We get small glimpses of the early days of the character, a wisecracking superhero not unlike Spider-Man or Deadpool, one would imagine. As the Cold War gets hot and heavy in proxy wars and behind-the-scenes black ops, we see the comedian change from a snarky jokester to one who sees a larger, not very funny joke, that of humanity and the ultimate futility of nuclear war, which he sees as inevitable.
Fireworks. You got to be kidding me. You know, you'd think this goddamn country had enough fireworks. You know, if we lost here in Vietnam, I think it might have driven us crazy. You know, as a country. But we didn't. Thanks to you.
You sound bitter.
Me? Bitter? Fuck no. I think it's hilarious.
Already a morally mess of a character, constant brutality and downright immoral acts he commits in service to his country give him an incredibly black but comic outlook on humanity. And here we see the late war and post-war humor had a particular taste lambasting the idea of good and evil, black and white, right and wrong, of the earlier 50s and 60s takes on the conflict. There is humor in the perceived ignorance and innocence of the time, as well as more openings to make fun of the Western side of things that were often hard to do back then without being called a pinko traitor. Coming fully nearly three decades after the conflict officially ended, Comrade Detective gives us a Cold War satire that plays with the idea of what East media would be like with Western 80s flair, while also poking fun at our own cop shows of the time as well as the conflict, now well past in our rear view and ripe for more nostalgia jokes and primed for modern satire comedy. Often resembling a satiric take on both Miami Vice and Hill Street Blues, the show uses the fake comedy's block backdrop in production to mostly celebrate and parody the 80s cop drama and our own ideas of what communism was during the end of the conflict in the 80s. But this is a small sample of what comedy related to the Cold War could be. Gallows humor, satire towards the genre's various tropes, and what has been created as a side to the conflict that's very much reliant on making fun of not only the genre and its tropes, but the era of conflict and how modern audiences tend to view that time in retrospect.